Lord Mountbatten was the son of a man named Prince Louis of Battenberg, and they were German immigrants. And Prince Louis was the first sea lord, that is to say, the senior professional officer in the British Navy, when Churchill became First Lord of the Admiralty. And then the war broke out with Germany, and he had to resign. And then they changed their name to, and their relations of the Queen from Germany. You know, in the First World War, so the Kaiser Wilhelm II, and the Tsar of Russia, they were Victoria's nephews. And she wrote them as Willie and Nicky. And, you know, and then they went to war and killed half the world, and many Britons. Anyway, that so there, it's all connected, right? And in the 20th century, there was a kind of severing of relations, you know, because they were killing each other. And families don't get along when they kill each other. And Prince Louis of Battenberg was a great man and a loyal Briton, but he had to quit because he was German. And so they changed the family name to Mountbatten. And these people are all, you know, related to the Queen. Mountbatten was the last Governor General of India. He was a commander in the same theater where MacArthur commanded for the United States in this, you know, in the Asian theaters. And you know, he rose to be chief of staff of the British military in his last service in the 60s. Well, he was killed by IRA terrorists. In what year? 79, I should know that. Yeah, and members of his family, children, were killed. And they blew up a boat. He was on vacation, the IRA. And, you know, Britain then proceeded to kill a lot of them, which was only right. Anyway, that's all there, right? And now if you're looking at that, if you're standing in the horse cars parade and you're facing 10 Downing Street, go to the left and you get to 11 Downing Street, and that's where the Chancellor of the Exchequer lives. And then that whole complex, all the way down to Whitehall Street, those are cabinet executive offices. So there's a cabinet meeting room in there, and there's offices for the senior officials who serve the cabinet, especially the secretary of the cabinet, who's a very important man. And during Churchill's, much of Churchill's life, the secretary was Norman Brooke, and he was a heck of a guy, very good. He's the one who, after Churchill was defeated, he was writing the Second World War, and you know, he got paid amounts that, by the time it was all paid, you know, something like $20 million for writing that. And so Churchill became well-to-do for the first time in his life. And was he going to get to use the cabinet papers? And some of that is in the next to the last document volume, and not the one we just finished, but the one before that, because Churchill's corresponding with them a lot. And you know, the Labour government, they whipped Churchill good, and politically, they really dislike each other. And there's a few that personally really dislike each other. But Churchill loved most of those guys. Because they were, in fact, Ernest Bevin, who was the foreign minister in the Labour government, Churchill himself brought him into politics, knowing he was a left-wing socialist, because he was this union guy, and he was tough as nails. And he organized Labour in the Second World War. So they're all getting on, right? And Churchill's having to write him letters and saying, hey, I want to use these papers. And of course, it's going to be famous, right? Everybody in the world is going to read this book. And then it comes up in the cabinet when it's announced what Churchill got paid by Henry Luce, and in Britain, very large amounts too, and all over the world. They wonder if we should have, you know, the government should get a piece of that. And you know, and we have the records of the discussion. It's very civil. And they vote unanimously no. You know, and that's because it's my point. After 1940, Winston Churchill was the greatest man in the world. And what I mean by that is that's how everybody treated him. If they opposed him, they still opposed him. But they altered how they did it to take account for the fact that he was the greatest man in the world. So, and Urine Bevin, a different Bevin, not Ernest Bevin, he was very left-wing, and he was a great taunter of Churchill. But he's also the guy who caused some of the most significant honors to Churchill. And when it came time to speak words about Churchill and his achievements, he was one of the best, although Clement Attlee was way the best. So that all that happened there, right? And the reason they made the 28th meeting, where the whole cabinet was invited, was moved to the a conference room in the House of Commons end of the Palace of Westminster, was because there was going to be more people there, and it would have been crowded. And for once, Churchill wanted everybody there, not crowded. But mostly those meetings all happen there, and those meetings still happen there, although most of the Treasury is located somewhere else now, because we live in the age of big government. Now, if you keep going, turning left and wheeling, so you're facing 10 Downing Street, and you go like this, that's the side of the Horse Guards Parade that faces Whitehall, and that's a long stretch of that's called Dover House. And Penny and I just looked it up. The Scotland offices are in there. And then that gives way to the left hand, as you're facing Whitehall Street, to the left hand end of it. That's where the Admiralty begins. And there's a brown brick section that faces Whitehall Street, and then abuts a section that comes off at a 90 degree angle. And that brown brick section is where the First Lord of the Admiralty lived. They don't live there anymore. In fact, I learned a couple of years ago that what's up in the, because, it's a very nice house, and Churchill lived in it quite a lot because he did that job twice. What's up in the top now is that cabinet ministers maneuver to get close to the prime minister because they let it out to cabinet ministers for periods of time. And then they've got a really great address in London, and that's kind of handy. Although the grand part of it is public now. They don't put people in there to live, I'm told. And then the part that goes at a 90-degree angle from Whitehall Street, that is the traditional, the old offices of the Admiralty, which was the greatest military force in human history up to its time. And those antennas, that was a marvel of technology, because they could meet the admirals and the sea lords, and they could run the Navy, and they could communicate with any ship anywhere in the world. Wow. Right out of those antennas. And, they were relayed to places and all that. But they had a very sophisticated system. And in former days, which were better days, if you looked at that place, you thought, nobody can resist that. That's too strong. That's where Nelson came from, and there might be more of them. And the Britain had these two generals and a sailor. And the thing about them was they were just completely lethal. They just never fought anybody they didn't whip. That's not fully true of Wellington, because he mostly fought from weakness and delayed and stayed in the Iberian Peninsula in Portugal and eventually Spain, because it was hard for the French to get troops over there, and that meant they'd get a few over and he'd bleed them for a while, and then they'd need to send more. And once Napoleon tried to break the logjam by going along the coast, skirting the southern end of the Pyrenees, and the British Navy came up and just destroyed vast numbers of troops with cannon fire. So they couldn't do that anymore. Anyway, Those three guys, more than anybody else, they made, they won the military victories that made this the seat of power in the world. So that Admiralty thing is really great. And if you look when you go back, if you're looking at the Admiralty, look up to the left and behind it, and there's a statue standing up there. And first of all, that street, it's Curzon Street, is one of the best addresses in the world. But, Lord Curzon lived there. And the statue was of him. Is that right, Richard? Do I remember that right? And there's a great story I'll tell you about him. He was a very capable man, very pompous man, too. He's very noble. And so Churchill said of him once, very indicative of Churchill's opinions, people style Churchill as an aristocrat. He was born high, but not high enough to get either a title or money. And he eschewed the principle of aristocracy. So Lord Curzon said famously once, and Churchill turned this into a great devastation, he said, the upkeep of civilization is the work of aristocracy. And that's how he talked. And Churchill said, it would be truer to say that the upkeep of aristocracy is the work of civilization. And he said, and Churchill goes on, he says, and see, he understood the literal meaning of that word, because Ariston means best, and arche means rule or ruling principle. Democracy, that means the rule of the tens, the rule of the many, right? Aristocracy means the rule of the best. Churchill says, I bet there was not a marquis or an earl who didn't delight in those statements by Lord Curzon, he said. But he did not mean real aristocracy. He meant the rule of the well-born. Not the most talented, not the bravest, not the most gifted, right? Churchill said, democracy is the fellowship of us all in the leadership of the best. Democracy is aristocracy, in other words. And that's exactly what the founders of America thought, too. And all that's a prelude to telling two great stories about Lord Curzon that are just awesome. The second is less awesome, but came later. Lord Curzon waited in his house there on that great street, and waiting because they were having a cabinet meeting, and they were going to come ask him to be prime minister. And they never got there. And he was disconsolate. But another time, and Churchill draws a picture in an essay he wrote in, published later in Great Contemporaries about Lord Curzon. He wrote many great sketches of people he knew, and they're just wonderful to read. A little bit like Plutarch's Lives. And he tells that story in Curzon's frustration and pacing up and down. But the better story is a bunch of cabinet members came into his house one time, and they were scheduled to have a talk, and he was very distraught, and he was pacing up and down. And somebody finally said, "What's wrong with you, my lord?" And he said, "My gardener has left me." And they said, "Well, you can get another gardener." And he said, "But do you know what he said to me?" "No." And he said, "I asked him why he was leaving." And he said, "Because you, my lord, are a son of a bitch." That messed up his day, you know. So that's what all that is. And, you know, it's fun. If you go anywhere with Martin Gilbert, you learn to do this. You never get one guidebook, always get two. And they'll have different information. And he would, if you go anywhere with him, he loved to walk, and he walked in jerks, and then he would suddenly stop. And you wouldn't move again until you'd figured out everything that happened in that place in human history. And mostly he knew. You know, if he flew on a plane, he always got the window seat, and he always watched, and he always sent notes to the pilot about what we were going over and what happened there. And so if you'd be on a plane that he was on, and the pilot would start giving this guided tour of history. Okay. So, do you have any questions? Yes, sir, Jeff.
You started that marvelous story by saying you were to explain the purpose of the changing of the guard.
Oh, yeah, sorry. It's a... I have ADD and I make a virtue of it. But, so that's military governing force, London, and the greatest in the world. And so the reason they do these the way they do it, I mean, first of all, the cavalry, you know, that was an awesome extension of arms. Churchill was a cavalry officer. He took part at Omdurman in the Sudan in the last big cavalry charge the British ever had. And his life was saved, he said, because he'd hurt himself getting on or off a boat, and he had a bad shoulder, And he was a big-time polo player, and it changed how he played, although he was really good. And so he couldn't swing a saber very well. And so he used a pistol. And, you know, because, and they, at the Battle of Armdom, and they actually launched this cavalry charge thinking there was only a few, but the desert is fools you because there'd be depressions in it you can't see. And they go over a rise they didn't know was there, and they're just a huge force, and they got to cut their way through it. Well, and the point was the cavalry, that was the fun. You know, Alexander the Great conquered the world by the first vital use of cavalry. That was his innovation. He made big, fat war horses brave, and he charged the center of the line. Wherever it was, he found the worst place, and he charged it, and he broke through, and then he turned in both directions, and he just cut the enemy to pieces, and he did it over and over and over again, all the way to India. Anyway, so that's the cavalry. And so the infantry guards Buckingham Palace and the tower, the cavalry guard the horse guards parade. And that ceremony, what it means is the guards, they're sentries, and they can be there by themselves. And that way, you know, if there's an attack, they'll get killed and the alarm will go up. But then they don't ride solo back and forth. They are escorted by a larger force because there might be an attack at any time. And so that ceremony, what it is coming to get the ones that are there and bringing the new ones and escorting the old ones back. And you notice that two things. You notice that the columns, because they have different functions, probably sergeant, I don't actually know, in charge of each column, they bark orders in answer to one another to coordinate the force. And then if you watch closely, you'll see the horses know the commands. And so every time when there's a big command after a silence, some of them will move too quick because they know what they're supposed to do. And one of them, this time, it'll be embarrassment. One of them actually started, he stopped him, and in the course of stopping him, he turned a circle right beside the sergeant, the worst thing that could happen, you know. So that's a, you know, and it's ceremony, but you got to remember it has a lethal derivation, and all of those people are crack troops, and they can fight, and they're good with weapons. And so that's what they do. And yeah, so that's what that's about. Do you want to say something, sir?
This question is whether it's urban legend or true that recording was not allowed when Churchill addressed the House of Commons, but he would subsequently go to the BBC and record his speeches. So he had to do his speeches twice. And the question relates to whether he got someone to impersonate himself for the BBC announcement.
So, do you hear that?
I heard rubbish.
Shut up, Richard. So the question is, was it urban legend or truth that Churchill got somebody to go give his speeches? And the answer to that question is yes. Let's just say it's either urban legend or true. So some parts of that are true and some are false. It is true that they didn't record in the House of Commons until
1977,
yeah. And yeah, Penny's niece, beautiful little girl, now has got little girls of her own. She's always been very well spoken, and the first thing she learned to speak were animal noises. But then, Fiona, what does the pig say? And she could oink. And what does the speaker say? Because this is what they said when they came on the BBC in the morning while she was having breakfast to go to school on the radio. It starts with the summary of the parliamentary debate starts with the speaker going, order, order, you know. So that little girl could do that to a T. Yeah, so the allegation by a a man well qualified to be called Jackass, was he said that he re-gave Churchill speeches.
Norman
Shirley. Is that who it was? Yeah.
Norman
Shirley. Yeah. Yeah.
He did,
I don't,
actually.
What?
He did, actually. Later on, he recorded one.
Well, yeah, but he didn't broadcast them on the radio.
No.
And so the thing about that is, first of all, most of them were not broadcast on the radio. Some of them were awesome. You know, they, you know, blood, not blood, toil, tears, and sweat, but the first one, the next week after he became prime minister, that was, you know, if necessary alone, if necessary for years, you know. It's very beautiful. But and some of those were meant for broadcast. When he rebroadcast the speeches that he'd given in the House, there's evidence that he was bored by that phenomenon. And he and people who heard both, especially Harold Nicholson, who kept a diary. So people who keep really big diaries tend to have an influence on how we understand history because you got the diary. He didn't give them as well. And you can get recordings of all of the ones that are recorded, and you'll see that they're like more and less lively. And but some of the ones that were not so lively, that if you listen to them, there are many like that for me, and I'm disappointed, you can go find what people wrote about them who heard the same speech in the House of Commons. And even Nicholson in particular, you know, Churchill was, one of the testimonies to his rhetorical power was people like Nicholson and people like Hugh Dalton, who kept the best notes of Churchill's speech about May the 28th, 1940, they just loved him. They didn't agree with him about anything, but he was the best show in town. And so there was huge attention on him. And then if he gave a radio talk and it wasn't very good, and they'd been telling all their friends, you got to hear this guy. And then it's a little flat. So there's records of people thinking that. But no, that guy didn't do that. And we know he didn't do it for a lot of reasons, but one of them is there's lots of testimony of people who watched them. And, you know, they sat and watched him do them. And a great one, and I can't remember the date, Richard maybe will, but Churchill had a great friend in Violet Bonham Carter, and she was the daughter of Herbert Asquith, the Prime Minister, and she's the grandmother of the actress Helena Bonham Carter, and she was a very beautiful woman, a liberal by party persuasion, and Churchill and she were very close friends for a long time. They got a little sweet on each other for a short time, but they were just really friends. And Churchill's way of courting women until he learned better was he would memorize martial poems with them. You know, that didn't work. But he did that with her. And there's one very famous one by Arthur Hugh Clough, "Say not the struggle not availeth." I haven't memorized them. I'll say a line or two. "Say not the struggle not availeth, the labor and the wounds are vain. The enemy faint not nor faileth, and as things have been, they remain." So you see, it's not, don't throw up your hands. And then, "If hopes were dupes, fears may be liars. It may be, in the smoke, yon smoke concealed, your comrades chase even now the flyers, and but for you, possess the field." Well, it goes on. There are two more. He goes, "I think I can do them all." He says, "Cracks and inlets making." I can almost do the third one. I have trouble with that one. But the fourth one is, "And not by eastern windows only, when daylight comes in the light. In front the sun climbs slow, how slowly. But westward look, the land is bright." Now that's perfect, you know, for a speech that Franklin Roosevelt's going to hear. And you know, Churchill was a very capable man. But when he finished that speech, he called Violet. "Violet," she said. And she was sobbing. He said, Did you hear our poem? Oh, Winston, she said. And you know, that was, what? That was 40 years ago that he'd memorized that poem with her. So that jackass, whoever he was, did not give that speech. Yeah. Out of time. Gotta go. Gotta go work. Snap two.